Let's get it going. Let's get it started. We have so much cool stuff to talk about, so many cool videos. I'm looking forward to sharing my experiences with making conservation relevant, because it's such a tricky, tricky topic, and it's a lot harder than what I thought it would be. So I'm looking forward to sharing that with you all. But if you are new and my face does not look familiar to you, hi everyone. My name is Bailey Ritter. I'm looking forward to becoming fast friends with all of you. Thank you for being in community again. I'm originally from Pontiac, Illinois. So shout out to Olivia, who's on the Zoom, who is also from Pontiac, Illinois, and anybody else who did not shout themselves out that they're from that area. Hello to you as well. If I could be an expert in anything, this, again, I've said this 100 times now. I've changed my answer 7 or 8 times, but right now I'm really stuck on Illinois natural history. And similar to Dennis, being able to ID plants, I'm pretty good with animals, but it's the natural Illinois plants I'm not good with, or just history in general. And, you know, actually knowing what it means to be formerly a wetland and where you live. So that would be my answer. And I can't wait to share my panelists' answers as well. But I'm the Youth Advisor for the Ocean Project. And at the very end, I'll share how to get involved with the Rising Blue Network that I'm a part of, that the Rise Up webinar is a part of, and how you can join this global youth movement to protect and take action for our shared blue planet. So I am honored to introduce you all to Naeem, who's popping up on his video. Can't wait to see it. He's arrived. But Naeem is an intern, a careers in science intern from California Academy of Sciences. And I saw a lot of SF people here in the chat. And if you've not been to the California Academy of Sciences, it's officially become on my bucket list to actually visit. So if you're in that area and you have not been able to visit, be a part of their programming, I'll share with you all at the end how you can get involved and how you can go check it out in both current COVID ways and hopefully once this pandemic ends in in-person ways as well. But I wanted to share a little bit about the Careers in Science program. So created in 1996, the Careers in Science intern program provides San Francisco youth from communities traditionally unrepresented in STEM fields with opportunities to immerse themselves in the sciences. And while we'll be talking a little bit about the sciences and different conservation topics, this episode of the Rise Up webinar is really about the creative side of things. How can we take some of these really hard, difficult, complex topics and turn them into relevant, interesting, fun pieces of art, mediums, videos, whatever that looks like for you. So Naeem will talk a little bit more about the program and the amazing things that they're working on over there. But I want to remind you all, like I always do, that if you have any questions for Naeem or any questions for any of the young people here that are a part of the Careers in Science program, please ask whenever they come to you. Put them in the chat, put them in the Q&A box. We can't wait to see what you all are thinking. So without further ado, I want to hand the floor over to Naeem.
Hey everybody. So as Bailey said, my name is Naeem. I'm a senior in high school, and like many of you here, I'm also from San Francisco. So I'm an intern at the California Academy of Sciences in a program called the Careers in Science Intern. We'll start off with a brief tour of the California Academy of Sciences.
Let's take a brief tour. The California Academy of Sciences is a research institute and natural history museum in San Francisco, California, that is committed to connecting people to the wonder of the natural world, the power of science, and solutions for a sustainable future. Welcome to the California Academy of Sciences, the only place in the world with an aquarium, planetarium, natural history museum, and four-story rainforest, all under one living roof.
The Academy of Sciences is located in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park and is California's oldest operating museum and research institution for the natural sciences. The Academy's vision is to explore, explain, and sustain life. Every visit supports scientific research, environmental education, and sustainability innovation around the world.
Has several environmentally friendly features, as well as a sustainable design inspired by the seven major hills of San Francisco.
The entrance is famous for the T-Rex that greets every visitor.
Come and say hi to the 17 African penguins.
The Morrison Planetarium is a dome with a 75-foot diameter, giving viewers an immersive experience. Inside the OSHA rainforest, a magnificent neotropical rainforest stretches 90 feet above. Delight in the exploits of 1,600 plus live plants and animals, including taxicab-like sun beetles, leafcutter ants hard at work, a slithering Amazonian tree boa, and several species of butterfly. Try to spot one.
The Academy is also home to the Steinhardt Aquarium, one of the most biologically diverse aquariums on Earth. It houses nearly 40,000 live animals, representing more than 900 unique species.
From the 1.5 million visitors who walk through its doors each year to the nearly 46 million scientific specimens in its collection, the Academy's impact starts right here at the museum.
Sign me up. As soon as it opens, as soon as the world opens, I'm going.
So the program is a multi-year, year-round paid internship and workforce development program for San Francisco high school students. The goal of the program is to diversify the STEM fields. Interns learn, teach, and conduct science. Within the program, we host around 30 interns a year. All interns participate in the program 2 to 3 years until high school graduation. The four components of CIS are trainings, where we meet every other week to learn about STEM and skills needed for STEM careers, project groups, where we work in small groups with STEM professionals, mentorships, we gain direct support from mentors in STEM fields, and what used to be public for work is now special interest groups, led by higher level interns where we choose a conservation related topic and do something about the issue. For special interest groups, our first step was to choose a topic. We created a list of about 20 options of topics among our three teams. We then created a forum asking our peers what they found most interesting. This chart shows the responses. Let's take a moment for a quick poll and share the topic that you find most interesting.
I'm really interested to see what you all are thinking is the most relevant in your communities. I know a couple of these, I was like, what? And even when I was looking at and talking to Naeem when we were, you know, talking about the webinar, I had no idea about the different things happening in environmentally in San Francisco, like, and other parts of the world. So it's really interesting, I think, to always see the environmental topics that are most prevalent in communities I've never been to. And so that's why I like, I want to see what your poll answers are.
Mm-hmm. Like issues that may be affected in San Francisco's may not be what affects you where you are.
Exactly. Has everyone put their answers in the poll? Okay. Wow, Naeem, are you able to see, the results?
I can't on my end. Oh, now I can. See, so it looks like environmental racism, climate change, and fast fashion got the highest votes.
Wow. I don't know if I'm shocked by this. I mean, these are topics that are top of mind for me, but it's really interesting to see you all say that as well. So this is really cool.
Yeah. So my teams actually thought that those were also the most interesting to them. So my group chose wildfires. We chose a topic. Our group chose wildfires. Human actions in our aid in climate change has dramatically increased the severity and frequency of fires. And although 100 corporations are in charge of 71% of carbon emissions, all of our individual actions play a role. Fires aid in the destruction of ecosystem and regrowth of others. Pollution of water sources and air and extreme fire events like we saw in 2020 are preventable with proper management. The next team chosen topic was fast fashion. Fast fashion is cheap and mass-produced clothing that target low-income populations. One of its environmental issues are emitting high amounts of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, as well as high waste production. Its societal issues consist of targeting low-income individuals who are looking for pay, resulting in them working in harsh conditions. The fast fashion corporations disregard the safety of humans and the environment, relaying the message that making money is more important than the welfare of human beings. So the question we asked was, how do we communicate these ideas to other teams? The answer was digitally, so through sources like YouTube, social media, and other videos. So here's the video that my team made on wildfires.
Every year, there are around 64,000 wildfires in the US, according to the Congressional Research Service. This graph from Statista shows the increases in wildfires over the years. We see a spike after 2000 because climate change is making dry seasons longer, increasing wildfires annually. Dry seasons are long because of Earth's tilt when the sun rays are shining at the northern hemisphere. It's usually more direct from June through August than any other time of the year. Due to climate change, dry seasons are increasing in length. These increasing fires aren't only affecting humans, but the surrounding ecosystems and animals as well. Whilst fires can serve as an element of new growth, they can also be detrimental to the surrounding ecosystems, destroying habitats, killing or severely injuring wildlife, and polluting the air with poisonous emissions. Smoke has many greenhouse gases, like carbon dioxide, that are released into the atmosphere. This heat gets retained, so it makes the Earth warmer, which contributes to climate change. Black carbon is a greenhouse gas that is released during fires, but it's only in the atmosphere for a few days or weeks. In this diagram, you can see how it traveled after a wildfire. Although it may seem only terrestrial organisms and ecosystems are being impacted, both aquatic and aerial organisms are being affected by the toxic smoke and poisonous ashes. Ash can enter and poison the water as well as the air, which the aerial organisms dwell. Large smoke clouds may cover the sun, preventing coral from photosynthesizing, allowing algae to grow over the dead coral and form colorful yet poisonous blooms. Large drastic events such as a fire and other natural disasters can cause a genetic bottleneck, resulting in the large genetically diverse population to become small, low genetic diversity, and uniform population. Wildfires can cause temporarily large increases in gaseous air pollutants such as carbon monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, and more. The effects wildfires can have on people's health range from eye irritation to more serious health issues such as reduced lung function, asthma, etc., and in very serious cases, premature death. Researchers hope this data will help communities in their wildfire risk. Distributing evacuation notices in multiple languages and also being able to offer jobs focused on thinning forests or clearing up flammable things can all help the risk of effects on communities. Around 90% of wildfires are caused by humans, so furthering education on the topic is crucial prevention. We do not want this cute little fire to go to this, especially in areas that are at a higher risk of wildfires like mid-slope and urban canyons. People can take precautions with daily actions that causes the decrease in fires. For example, when it comes to camping, make sure to properly put it out and have a controlled fire. And when cooking, always make sure to stay alert and do not leave the food unattended.
We know sea level rises and the heat becomes stronger. We also know that fires are a huge contributor to this national problem. Some ways we can minimize climate change is by making small changes to our daily lives. Some of these being purchasing sustainable products, taking public transportation, disposing trash properly, decreasing our meal intake, and more. Human actions and our aid in climate change has drastically increased the severity and frequency of fires. And although 100 corporations are in charge of 71% of carbon emissions, all of our individual actions play a role.
Clap, 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 clap.
So next we have the fast fashion team's video that they chose to relay their message through TikTok.
Fast fashion has a huge impact on our earth. What exactly is fast fashion? Fast fashion are fast and cheaply made clothing sold on a wide scale, similar to fast food restaurants but with clothing. Stores like H&M, Uniqlo, and Forever 21 are some of the biggest fast fashion corporations. How does this exactly affect our earth? Around 85% of clothing ends up in landfills. They can also end up in rivers, oceans, or parks, which can cause additional environmental hazards. Luckily, there's still some things you can do to help. You can buy less clothing or swap and donate unused ones. Please keep this in mind about how damaging fast fashion is to the world and what you can do to help reduce fast fashion.
Fast fashion is killing our earth. They produce micro seasons that are gone within weeks. They have excess productions, overconsumptions, and waste. Companies take advantage of places with low labor laws and end up hurting the people and the environment. With 85% clothing that ends up in the landfills, it causes casualties to workers and the environment around them. It pollutes our water, land, and air. About 31% of plastic pollution is in the oceans due to the microfibers in fast fashion. But there are ways to help. There are many ways to break the fast fashion habit and to save the planet. For example, buying clothes from sustainable brands. Think twice before throwing out your clothes. Try to repair them, donate them, or put them in the recycling bin. There are many ways, and you can research them on the internet as well.
Hopefully you guys have heard of the term fast fashion. Fast fashion causes numerous problems within the environment, and even for us humans as well. So, as you saw before, Forever 21, instead of shopping from a big corporation like that, try looking in your closet again. And if you can't find the complete outfit, try looking in your sister's closet. Yes, that's pink, but it's cuter than what the model was wearing. Y'all can't lie. Anyways, and voila! Sorry, it's a little blurry, but I'm running on iPhone 6. Okay, bye!
Why the urge to make fast, cheap, trendy clothing needs to stop. Fast fashion is responsible for 10% of the greenhouse gases emitted to the atmosphere, causing global warming and contributing to natural disasters like strong winds, floodings, and even hurricanes like Hurricane Eta, which has left many families in Central America without their homes and some to sleep. So next time you go shopping, think about the impact it has on people around the world and our planet. Choose quality over quantity.
A third team created this video on the topic of racism in science communication.
When you think of a scientist, what comes to mind?
They don't look like me.
Do they look like you?
When I envision a scientist, I've always pictured a white man in a laboratory, because those were the images that surrounded my science class. There weren't any images of female scientists and or of color in my textbooks. It wasn't until I started volunteering at the California Academy of Sciences through a program called TASC that I got really interested in science. I loved it because I got to learn science in a fun way while also teaching science to the Academy visitors. I'm now an intern at the Cal Academy through an internship called Careers in Science. It's a great internship because I get to work with peers who are just like me, striving to become a scientist in a white and male dominated field. Equitable science communication is important because without it, I would have never thought I could become a scientist.
Let us define racism in science communication. Racism is prejudice, discrimination, or antagonism directed against a person or people on the basis of their membership of a particular racial or ethnic group, typically one that is a minority or marginalized. Science communication is a practice of informing, educating, raising awareness of science-related topics, and increasing the sense of wonder about scientific discoveries and arguments.
So, how are these two terms connected? According to the London School of Economics and Political Science Impact blog, research has demonstrated current science communication is frequently a Eurocentric endeavor governed by white Western cultural norms and too often perpetuating racist ideologies. As much as science communicators might wish otherwise, it excludes people.
Let's look at the barriers that prevent science from being communicated to diverse audiences.
Half of US adults read at the 7th grade level and below, and half read at an 8th grade level and above. Only 2% of global adults read at a top level. Usually, science news is expressed with complex vocabulary. This poses a problem for Americans who do not have the resources nor access to attain the right vocabulary. If science is expressed with complex vocabulary, a whole community is disenfranchised. As Dion L. Rossiter said, using words people can't understand leads to the perception of neutrality.
To be classified as science literate, one must be able to understand approximately 20 out of 31 scientific concepts and terms similar to those that would be found in the articles that appear in the New York Times weekly science section and in an episode of the PBS program Nova. Why is it important to have a population wise in science? The many reasons include the need for a more sophisticated workforce, a need for more scientific literate consumers, and equally as important, a scientific literate electorate who can help shape public policy.
TV is where most Americans prefer to get their news. However, science is mainly communicated through articles. If most people get their information from the television, why aren't science topics made more accessible to this wide audience?
The majority of newsroom employees are white men. We see very few people of color in journalism. Diversity in the newsroom is important because these group of individuals are the ones who decide what is posted on the news. If we have diversity, we can break racial barriers and we can reach out to more diverse communities.
There shouldn't be a science communication barrier. Everyone deserves to understand scientific topics. The importance of increasing public understanding of scientific issues continues to rise. Marginalized communities are not only disproportionately affected by these issues, like health and the environment, they are also not well served by the mainstream science media or traditional educational systems, and are faced with long-lived cultural and societal prejudices that perpetuate inequality.
By directly involving specific communities in the science communication processes,
addressing issues of increasing importance to the communities,
and presenting scientific role models and spokespersons from within those communities,
we can begin to ensure that science communication and education is really available and accessible to all.
Wow. I don't know about any of you watching, but I'm like, wait, go back to the first one? Like, I need to watch all of these again, take notes, and like, let all of this information sink in, because I've been studying, learning about environmental topics for years now, and I don't think I knew some of this information. So blown away, Naeem.
Yeah, I want to give a big shout out to all of my team members who made those amazing videos, and being able to come up with different ways of communicating their message to issues that are important and present really everywhere in the world.
I completely agree. I think, you know, I want to pose this question to everyone asking, what are relevant mediums for you all? You know, TikTok videos, what else? I mean, webinars, is this relevant for you? Is watching a TV show more relevant? Is a podcast a, you know, where would you prefer to learn and communicate and use your scientific information, your conservation information? Where would you like to see that go? What are some of your favorite places to get relevant information about science, things happening around the world, the news of the environment? Where do you prefer to get that, Naeem?
Personally, I think something that's kind of been my go-to sources getting new information has been TikTok, just because so many different people are on there sharing a lot of different information, because so many people my age and all different ages are on there, they're being able to get their message out to people across the world.
Yeah, I agree. I had my first experience with Instagram Reels this week. And it's much harder. I give so much credit to you all making those videos, but credit to all of those amazing TikTokers and, you know, Instagram Reel makers who put so much time, energy, and research into these super informative videos. It's so much harder making those than it took me a day to make a 15-second video. Like, it's way harder than what I think a lot of people realize, but has become kind of like a source of information, science, data, news, that a lot of people turn to. Like I said, people watching, put in the chat, where do you prefer to get this information? Where is cool for you? I want to ask you a couple questions, Naeem, and pick your brain. I've absolutely enjoyed talking with you over, you know, the last couple of weeks, you know, planning for this webinar. So I'm really looking forward to the audience kind of also being able to pick your brain. So definitely put your questions in the chat. But what inspired you to get involved in this type of work, in advocating for our planet and doing so in a really creative way?
I think probably what caused me to kind of fight for climate change is because at a young age, teachers and all the adults and a lot of people my age life, they always told us that we were the kids who were going to grow up and fight and fix climate change. So we've always had that being engraved in our brain since a young age. So I guess once I got to an age where I could actually start, well, where I thought I could start doing something about the issue is once I started doing more work. So interning at the Careers in Science internship at a museum who's really big on conservation and just getting to learn more about that. Just participating in a lot of other programs that teach you about climate change and how it affects different communities, even though it's a worldwide issue.
I heard that same thing as a kid. Like, you guys are gonna save us all. Like, you're the generation that is just gonna take care of all of this. And I don't know about you, but every time I've heard that from somebody it's typically someone like older telling young people this, I'm like, you're still on this planet too. Like, yeah. You still have stuff to do. Like, you can't wash your hands of this. But I think it's really inspiring that, you know, and just really interesting to me that you were just, that was ingrained. It was just like, you have to do it. Like, this is what the future is going to be. And, you know, we all got to stand up. So I think that's interesting, because I don't know if, especially when I was a lot younger, even in like junior high, like, I don't know if that was the conversation, you know, and maybe that's just because, you know, my community, maybe it's different in other communities. I don't mean to generalize, but I think that's really interesting. Something that you said, though, sparked another question that I have is, like, why? Why do we even have to make this relevant? That's something, you know, as I'm preparing for this webinar, something I've been thinking a lot about is, like, shouldn't these topics, these really life-altering topics, you know, climate change, the future of our ocean, wildfires, shouldn't they just be relevant? Like, shouldn't they just shouldn't people just care because, like, their, you know, live species are at stake? Why do you think we, you know, have to make them fun, cute, short videos in order to get people engaged?
Like you said, I think it should be something that we don't really have to broadcast, but should just be in people's mind, but I think just the difference in different conditions that people live in could be one of the issues why some people may not be able to fight for climate change. An example could be people in developing countries. They don't really have the luxury to cut back on certain energy uses when all they have is that small finite source of energy. Whereas in developed countries, some do have the luxury, so they can fight against it and kind of cut back on their energy uses. I think it's important that we still continue to promote these issues, because if we don't promote it, then that word isn't going to get across to the people who aren't really understanding the message. Also feel like it's our job kind of to help out the people who maybe still are developing, so they won't have to rely on using that fossil fuel, or they can turn to maybe having solar farms rather than having to dig in the coal mines.
That was such an eloquent, beautiful answer. I completely agree. I think something that, you know, when you were talking that kind of sparked something in my brain is going back to the video, right? Of like, you know, in thinking about the, you know, trying to make it relevant, you know, something that isn't relevant is these dense, hard to read scientific papers that can be quite overwhelming if you're not versed in that scientific language. And so, you know, in a lot of ways as communicators, allowing people to fit in and find a place by making them TikToks, by meeting them where they're at, you know, because there's a ton happening on this planet besides, you know, plastic pollution. You know, while that's a really heavy and a really massive topic, there are a ton of other things happening in our lives. I mean, a global pandemic, for starters, like there's a lot of things that people are thinking about. So I loved that answer of, you know, we got to meet them halfway. And it's not that it isn't relevant for them. It's that, you know, perhaps they don't know where they fit into the conversation yet. And by meeting them on a platform that they're at, you know, that bridges that gap. How do you, you know, when you're talking to your friends, when, you know, you're hanging with your family, like, how do you keep it relevant when you're like, hey, there's this massive thing that just came out in the IPCC report about climate change. Like, how do you naturally do that without being like, hey, friends and family, I made you a TikTok. Like, I made you a video to explain this topic. Because I wish I had that kind of time too, but we don't always. So how do you keep it relevant when, you know, just chatting with people?
I guess because I'm in San Francisco, it's kind of something that's always relevant, especially since we are a coastal city. So climate change is kind of directly affecting San Francisco, especially the underprivileged neighborhoods. And so just it's organic. It just comes up organically when discussing general issues. And I think that because, like I said before, it just depends on where you are. It may be easier for the issue to be more organic rather than maybe if you're the middle of the United States or a certain country where you're not necessarily surrounded by water, oceans rising may not be an issue that you're talking about.
I mean, it was certainly not a topic I was talking about in rural Illinois. We were talking about a lot of other things, a lot of other valid problems, issues happening, but sea level rise, not one that we talked about just like at the supper table, unless like my dad is a science teacher, so maybe he would talk about it, but not normally. Yeah, I completely relate to that. Here's a question actually in the chat from Shelby. What focus, if any, do you put on establishing credibility in making TikToks and making videos and, you know, kind of being a source of information for other teens?
Usually when it's kind of science-based, since a lot of companies have created their own TikToks, that's usually, I think, would be a credible source to go directly off of them. But if there are people who make TikToks on an environmental issue, I think it's best to look into it and not just assume that it's correct information, because just because it's on TikTok or any source, if it's on YouTube or anything, doesn't necessarily mean it's true. So looking into the issue more and seeing if that is true.
I agree. It's a starting point, right? Like, it's a jumping off. Like, I'll learn about a topic or a concept, and it'll, like motivate me instantly to, like, go down a Google rabbit hole. Every time I move my hands, it's also going out of focus. But go down a Google rabbit hole trying to learn more. And I either it gets proven right by me or proven wrong by me. And then I feel kind of like a scientist myself figuring it out. So that's a really good question. How do you, Naeem, you know, if you're scrolling through TikTok or even scrolling through Instagram, scrolling through anywhere that you get any information, how do you, you know, how do you trust different, you know, pieces of information? Like, what's something when you're looking at, you know, video, a picture, infographic, or whatever, what are some things that you think in your head, like, oh, I think that is credible, or like, I should probably look more into that?
So I'll use the same advice I just gave. I'll look more into it. I'll look at the source itself. So if it comes from, say it's a issue about space, so maybe NASA posted it, then that's a credible source, but still look into it. Whereas if I just posted something about stars and I said meteors are coming down, I would suggest that people look more into that because I'm not a credible source myself.
Yeah, same. I'm like, this doesn't seem legit. Yeah, I think we've all grown up, and correct me if anybody else on the Zoom or on the webinar, you know, thinks differently, but like, I feel like I've like grown accustomed to like being my own kind of detective kind of with content. Like, I just think I think we're all in a generation where we're naturally a little like, maybe, like, let me investigate, especially if you're interested in the topic. And again, don't mean to generalize, because I know, you know, maybe that's not the case for some people, but I think we're pretty, I think this community of people is especially, of young people is especially like, I'm gonna ponder that some more and then talk about it and, you know, share that information. Wow, why is this going so fast? Can we have another hour where we're just continuing to talk? If anybody does have a question for Naeem, please, please, please put it in the chat or the Q&A box. But something that I wanted to ask you is what tips do you have for me or anybody watching who, you know, are looking to create engaging content, like engaging ideas, you know, in conservation videos or TikToks or whatever it is? You know, are there tips that you learn from this process that you can share?
I think the biggest one would probably just be, no matter how small or big your idea is, just go for it. It probably will start off small, but just build communications, build connections. And so you have a bigger team to work with. And then over time, your small project will grow into something bigger. I actually started my own community garden over the summer. And that started off really, really small. I was by myself. I was looking for empty lots to start the garden, but I built a connection with San Francisco Recreation and Parks. And so I was provided a space from that. And so right now I have a full garden. I'm working with community members. I have my own team of youth, high school youth that I'm working with. And eventually the food that I grow is going to be given to members in my community. My community is a food desert and underprivileged. And so we don't really have many healthy resources. And so that's something I wanted to provide to my community.
I'm so glad you mentioned that, because as soon as, you know, both the team program supervisor Dennis told me about it, but then you and I were talking about it, Naeem, I just thought it was a perfect example of taking the things that you've learned and turning them into action and actually impacting your community in such a profound way. So congrats on everything, both with the community garden, but with the careers in science internship. You know, I think everyone watching, I think this is a really, like I said, a prime example of, you know, this webinar, for example, it was started out of like, hey, I want something like this. Like, I want a cool fast fashion specific TikTok, right? If maybe that's something you care about. Like, I would love to follow that myself. Create it yourself. Like, do it. Like, I know that's easier said than done, but you all have platforms in your pockets, in just life that, you know, I don't know if you realize how profound those platforms are. So don't be afraid. I think that's another piece of advice and something that I learned from you all is that, like, don't be afraid. I know it can be kind of nerve-wracking. I remember the first time that I started talking out about, hey, friends, do you see what's happening on the planet? Like, I was so scared that they were going to be like, can we just get back to the movie? Like, can we just go, like, we're going shopping. Like, what is this about? And they weren't. They were like, wait, what? And that's how I built my communication skills, is learning weird pieces of information on the internet about what was happening on the planet and telling my friends about it. And that became sort of like a friend little meetings we would have, like in the cars. I would be like, hey guys, this week I learned blank. And it can be kind of what Naeem was saying, as kind of foundational as that, having conversations to, my gosh, creating a community garden, because that's relevant and needed in your community. So don't hesitate or be afraid to provide what you're looking for, and be the person who you want to be, like, and provide the content that you want to see. So I did want to share, because we're like so running out of time, because we always do that. I want to share how you can get involved with both the California Academy of Sciences, how to get involved in general in this work. I have this cute little, there, I have my fish moving. if you are wanting to get involved with Cal Academy, I'm a QR code gal. So take your phone, take a picture of the QR code and scan it. You'll be taken to their website. And if you're wanting to get involved with the Rise in Blue Network and other opportunities like this Rise Up, or like this webinar, different youth events, scan that QR code on that left-hand side. And if you are making TikToks, if you're making cool infographics, if you're creating really innovative Instagram stories, or even writing your own youth publication or magazine, share them with us, share them with me. DM me, tag us using the hashtag Rise Up Webinar, so that potentially you could be on this next webinar. And if, like always, if you have a topic or you are in a youth organization or know of a youth organization that you think would be really cool to share with this Rise Up audience, please let me know. I'm always looking, obviously, for other really innovative and cool people like Naeem. So again, thank you all so much for being here. You know the drill. Please message me, DM me. And if you have any questions about the California Academy Science Careers in Science internship, please use that email, youthprograms@calacademy.org, and give them a shout. And if you just liked what they're doing, also give them a shout. Send them an email saying, I loved what you're doing. You're cool. They'll appreciate that as well. So again, I can't thank you all enough for being here. I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful rest of 2020. It seems impossible, impossible that it's done, almost done. Naeem, Dennis, to the team at the Careers in Science internship at Cal Academy, thank you all so, so, so much for being here. I hope you all have a lovely, lovely, lovely rest of the year. Keep making change, keep being the role model that you wanted in your life, because you're all role models to me. So thanks again. You all rock. I can't wait to see you in the new year. Yay. Okay. Bye everyone. Have a great rest of your week. See you in the new year.